Hello and welcome to today's video. Today we'll be looking at Eli Tomac's very first interview since getting hurt earlier this year and what he has to say about Jet Lawrence's dominance. Then we'll take a look at an injury update on Austin Faulkner after a gnarly first turn crash. We'll then take a listen to Chase Sexton and his thoughts on the track changes at Washougal. Hint, hint, he didn't like it. After that, we'll take a look at RJ Hampshire and his revealed illness. Finally, we'll look at Hayden Deegan's controversial podium interview that got the internet's panties in a bunch. And then on the MXGP side of things, we only have one story, but it's regarding the now four-time GP winner in a row, Factory Kawasaki's Romain Fevre. Before I get into today's news, head to the MXNetwork.com or click the link in the description to go grab a magazine. Thank you to all of you guys who did. I've been getting a lot of orders lately. Thanks so much on that. But yeah, site-wide sale, $2.99 each. So if you want to support my work directly, go snag a couple. Today's Moto News is brought to you by Sweet Life CBD. Sweet Life has some of the best CBD products like gummies, topicals, oils. So if you're in pain, head to getsweetlife.com and use code TMN to get 20% off all CBD products. All right, for the very first story of the day, we have none other than the Monster Energy Star Racing Yamaha rider Eli Tomac finally breaking his silence at the Alpine Star Ride Day after Washougal. As you know, Eli likes to keep to himself, so we really haven't heard his opinions on this year's racing or how Jet's doing or if he'll be returning and when. Well, Sunday he finally broke his silence at the Alpine Stars MX24 line debut, and he pretty much gave us 100% reassurance that he will be back. Here's that clip.
Yeah, so it's Sunday, we're out here at Washougal, checking out all the new Alpine Star gear. Everything's looking sweet. And yeah, update on myself is I've just been working on physical therapy, getting this Achilles back to what I think is going to be 100%. So far, it's going really well. I'd say I'm a few weeks ahead of, ahead of protocol. So for me, it's been great, great recovery so far. And I think there's more racing in my future.
Now, he definitely doesn't seem like a guy who's going to retire to me. As I said in the previous video, regarding his health, he seems to be ahead of normal protocol, and Eli just confirmed that, so that's great to hear. Now, not only did he talk about himself, but he was asked what he thought about Jet Lawrence and his undefeated season thus far. Here's what Eli thought about that.
Seeing Jet win, you know, this many motos in a row is so impressive, just because knowing what it takes to win races and to have that consistency and that discipline, especially year one is next level. So
it's pretty awesome to see a legend of the sport recognize this kid's talent. Hopefully in 2024 we have some Tomac Lawrence Sexton battles. It'd be pretty awesome to see, that's for sure. All right, our next story of the day is regarding Pro Circuit Kawasaki rider Austin Faulkner. Now, Faulkner's been out for most of the year and most of the past few years due to injury, and he finally made his return to Pro Motocross last weekend. He rode relatively consistent and seemed to stay on two wheels, which was good for him. While this weekend in Washougal, he already ended up back on the ground in a pretty rough crash. In the first moto, Faulkner got a bad start and ended up crashing in the back of the pack, resulting in him getting sucked up by the back tire of another rider. It's pretty rough to watch, but here's those clips. Somehow Faulkner managed to climb back onto his bike and finish out the moto, and he almost got himself back into points paying positions with a 21st place finish in Moto 1, which is pretty good considering he was 40th, way behind the pack at the beginning. Faulkner ended up giving a health update on his condition after the crash in a post-race statement saying, quote, "Well, that's what happens when you get a bad start. Super fortunate that it wasn't worse, but man, I gotta be better. Disappointed with how I rode in the second moto as well. Need to be faster, need to be fitter, and need better starts. Got sucked into someone's rear wheel with my body and drug down the start straight, as you can see. Chest, side, and back are super scraped and beat, but live to fight another day. Shout out to the fans. I was last in the first moto after I got back up and heard you guys cheering for me every lap, so thanks for that. Y'all are awesome. I'm glad to see he's all right. At this point, I'd like to see Faulkner just finish out the season healthy. I mean, he's been hurt for every season for like 5 years, so let's take it easy, Faulkner. Just finish it out, get some experience. On to our next story regarding Honda HRC rider Chase Sexton. Sexton obviously didn't have the weekend he wanted or the fans wanted, as he was expecting to be a little more faster and push towards Jet, which obviously didn't happen. After the race, Sexton admitted to making mistakes and just not having the speed Jet did, and that he needs to work on it. but he also commented on how the track changed and how disappointing it was. This year especially, we've been seeing a lot of track changes, added features, added dirt, and it seems the riders aren't happy with it. For Washougal, it seems they added sand in some sections, which obviously isn't normal for a Northwestern Woods track, and Chase Sexton was open about his disliking of this change. Sexton basically said that they're making all the tracks the same and taking away any variability, which is pretty true. Hear from the man himself.
I just think there needs to be diversity between the tracks, and if they're trying to put sand on all of them, they're kind of all the same. To be honest, I feel like Redbud, even nowadays, has more sand on it than I was used to in the past, and I kind of liked it more without the sand. And Millville, super, like, has sand on top, but it's hard packed underneath that. I just feel like they're trying to change these tracks and them being all the same, and this one, they try to put sand on it. I didn't like it that much, but everyone has to ride the same thing. And the ruts, it was super wet this morning, but I almost feel like it dried out even more than it usually does, which is kind
of
weird.
The end of your segment, that's what I was saying, like, it's...
So yeah, he seems to think that making these changes at all the tracks make them kind of the same, which, in my opinion, is 100% true. I think we have to keep it the way MXGP kind of does it, you know, natural layouts, very minimal foreign soil added to the tracks. What are your guys' thoughts on this? All right, our next story is on Rockstar Husqvarna rider RJ Hampshire, who is still technically in the 250 class title fight, even though he's far out and still battling Hayden Deegan in super motocross points. Hampshire has remained quite consistent over the past few races, making subtle improvement, but revealed in the post-race interview after Washougal that he's been run down with an illness and it's been affecting his health, training, riding. Here's what Hampshire had to say about that.
I've been struggling with my stomach so bad, you know, the last few weeks, and hasn't gotten better. It's getting worse. It didn't really affect, like, my strength necessarily. Like, I would just be hurting second moto. But yeah, dude, I was weak out there. Second moto, crashed twice. Yeah, I just didn't have it, which was a bummer. All in all, I mean, these next three races are all tracks I really ride well at. Got plenty of doctor's appointments, you know, these next 3 weeks to try to get recovered a bit, because, I mean, that's kind of where I'm at. It's like, you know, I feel good during the week, and then I show up on the weekends, and it hasn't been good. I mean, I've been in almost Prado shoes the last 4 or 5 weeks.
We're almost getting the Soiler self-quotes here.
Yeah, I mean, it's, man, I don't know really what it is. Honestly, I'm kind of basing it back to that crash I had at Anaheim.
It sucks to hear that once Hampshire finally gets up to speed and comfortable, he gets sick. So hopefully he doesn't end up in Prado's shoes. We don't want to see that again. Obviously, with him struggling with the illness and Deegan finding his stride, it's probably going to be hard for Hampshire to keep up in SMX points, but we'll see what he can figure out over the break. We wish RJ the best and hope he's feeling better by Unadilla. The next story of the day is a straight-up ridiculous one, in my opinion, and that is the backlash that Hayden Deegan has gotten for his podium interview at Washougal. Before I get into the backlash and what people had to say about it, first watch the clip in case you don't know what I'm talking about.
I've been watching too much David Goggins and Andrew Tate. Those last few laps, I'm like, I'm putting my heart into this thing, baby. And man, it's nerve-wracking, and I'm sure it's nerve-wracking for Hunter, too. He's supposed to be winning these things, and I'm glad I could beat the American up front for all the fans.
Now, the first thing many people were saying is that he had no respect for his competitors, which I'm assuming they're talking about his Hunter Lawrence comment. I don't know how that is disrespectful. He's saying the truth. Hunter Lawrence was a championship favorite coming into the season and was dominating up until his two unlucky weekends in Redbud and Southwick. So, yeah, he is supposed to be winning. The fact that a rookie beat him, it's not very good. It doesn't look very good for Hunter Lawrence or the Honda boys, but he's not wrong. Now, in regards to his David Goggins and Andrew Tate things, I'm not even going to begin on that argument. Firstly, what's wrong with a kid looking up to a retired Navy SEAL who is known for his mental fortitude? He's a former world record holder and a multi-time best-selling author. David Goggins is one of the nicest and toughest men on the planet, so no problem here. I'm not even going to comment on the Tate things as they're too controversial and YouTube's not a fan of it, so I'm going to stay silent on that, but here's what some people had to say. Pulpamex host Steve Mathis said in a tweet, quote, "I remember when kids looked up to astronauts and stuff." There were a lot of other ones from not very prominent people on Twitter, but it's a plethora of people were flipping out about this. I think it's just kind of ridiculous to flip out about a kid who watches people to motivate him to be the best version of himself. Who cares? Now, should he have said that on the podium? I personally wouldn't, because look at the backlash he got in the first place. So, yeah, I wouldn't have done that, but he did it. It's too late. Everyone's mad at him. Who cares? All right, the final story of the day is about Factory Kawasaki MXGP rider Romain Fevre, Fevre began the year expecting to be a podium regular and kind of push himself back into that championship talks. Well, in recent weeks, he's dominated, as he has won 4 GPs in a row now, which hasn't been done in the while. Now, here's the crazy part. Romain is arguably the fastest man on the planet, and he doesn't have a deal in place for 2024, which is kind of insane. Now, yes, he does have some lined up, and he is using his speed and ability to his advantage. Here's what Romain had to say about the no-contract scenario.
I guess you said on TV that you're not signed for next year, which is true, obviously. You've won 4 GPs in a row, so is the interest from other teams, the offers, are they what you expect as a 4-time GP winner in a row, or are you happy with the situation?
Yeah, sure, I'm not. I would like that it's been done already, but yeah, we are discussing. Options are there, but... We're waiting for finalizing some deal. But for sure, to win where I am now, nobody can give you a shit offer. nobody can reproach me anything because I'm winning. Yeah. I'm winning, so I'm good. Yes.
I'm glad to hear he is in the works of signing a deal and that he's using his performances as leverage. I mean, seriously, you can't give this guy a bad offer at this point. I'm pretty sure every team in the paddock is knocking on his door, and as he is not intending on staying with Kawasaki for next year. Maybe he does, who knows, only time will tell. But I'm glad to see Fevre finally finding his flow once again and using that leverage to get a good contract. Well, that's all the news I have for you guys today. I wish I had a special guest lined up, but hopefully in the next couple days we can get some guys on. Thank you for watching. Subscribe if you're on YouTube. Follow if you're on Spotify. Go snag a magazine and support our sponsor, Sweet Life CBD. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.